Bernie, I think that it's time to start our seminar, extraordinary seminar today. Our invited speaker is Professor Jürgen Gutowski from Bremen University. He is going to talk about fundamental optics and optics technological applications, including sustainable technology, from the research group in Bremen University. Some biography data. Professor Gutowski got his habilitation in experimental physics, nonlinear optics of semiconductors in 1988. In 1985, he presented dissertation on experimental physics, spectroscopy, highly excited cadmium sulfur crystals. 1982, he got his diploma in physics. The diploma thesis was about bound excitons in cadmium sulfur from Technical University of Berlin, Germany, the stage. Since 1991 to present, he is professor of experimental physics. He is the head of the semiconductor optics group in the University of Bremen, Germany. Regarding his research interests, well, he's working in wide bandgap semiconductors, LEDs and lasers, design and optical characterization, active layers of low dimensionality, in particular quantum dots, vertical cavity, surface emitting lasers, low dimensional semiconductor structure, quantum wells, quantum wires, quantum dots, optical properties and their confinement and external fields, functionalization of low-dimensional semiconductor structures, other semiconductor structures, nanowires producing solar cells, detectors, and so on. Regarding his scientific merits, he has more than 350 publications in peer-reviewed journals. He has given numerous invited talks and seminars. He is Carl Scheele Award of the Physical Society of Berlin in 1987. He belongs to different scientific and reviewer committees, such as reviewer on numerous scientific journals, reviewer on numerous funding agencies, including DFG, numerous memberships and programs committees of international conferences, chairman of several international conferences and seminars, vice president of the University of Bremen from 1994 to 1997, dean of the Faculty of Physics and Electrical Engineering from 1989 to 2003 years. And well, she has got economical support through different funded projects. So please, thanks to the visit of Professor Gutowski.
So thank you very much for this kind introduction and for the invitation to CIO. I'm very much proud that I got the opportunity to present a bit of my research here. Don't worry, the title has been a little bit changed due to Heide Nolasco. We asked me to give a tutorial talk for the students at Vera Cruz, but the content is just the same. I would like to start with some few transparencies on Bremen, since I'm afraid that not everybody of you will know which city Bremen is, and that Bremen possesses a powerful university. Bremen is located in the northern part of Germany, as you see here. The University of Bremen was founded in 1971, so that's not an old university. It has now about 20,000 students, 2,300 scientists, and a bit more than 320 professors. This is the modern entrance hall of the university, and in the background you see the symbol of our university. This is a drop tower whose height is 140 meters, which is not very much impressive, but the impressive thing is that in the inner shape of this drop tower you will find 122 meters vacuum tube, for gravitational free experiments. That means simply you put capsules on the top of the tower and let them drop down in the vacuum. And this gives you 4.7 seconds of gravitational free situation. You may think 4.7 seconds, what can you do with that? I can assure you that even many, many engineering questions can be answered during that short time. And the second thing is that it is much cheaper to hire drop tower time than to hire time in the ISS. That would be extremely expensive, but even if you take a parabola flight, it is much more expensive than here. So this drop tower, if you want to make experiments over there, you should ask for time 2 years ago, since it's fully booked off. There's only 3 drop towers internationally active, and Bremen is one of them. This is an air view of the campus of University of Bremen, very much concentrated, and the faculties which are most included in the research on materials are my own faculty 1, which is a combination of physics and electrical engineering. Then we have biology, chemistry, maths and informatics, information science and production engineering. But I will only talk today about my own activities in this faculty. So there are some other symbols of the city of Bremen. If you have the occasion of the, to visit Bremen, you should not miss to visit our Universum Science Center with a very splendid architecture. Some call it a whale. And on the inside, you can touch everything. You can conduct scientific experiments by yourself. So it's very fascinating. This is the symbol of the city of Bremen, the Bremen city musicians. I don't know whether you've heard about this world famous fairy tale of 4 old animals approaching the city of Bremen. Since they were no longer needed in their former duties, they decided to go singing and collect money for that. But their singing was so horrible that they met some robbers in the forest and wanted to sing for them, and the robbers disappeared immediately. So the animals took over the house of the robbers, and the story says they never reached Bremen. But nevertheless, this is a symbol of the city of Bremen. And the story is that you, if you are in Bremen and touch these animals, you will come back. Okay, I guess most of you will know that. It is the most famous product of the city of Bremen, Beck's beer. I guess it is sold all over the world. You have very nice beers here in Mexico, but I guess you will also get Beck's beer if you like in some places. Okay, now let's start with the science. I will touch 4 activities of my group. The first one is lasing into 6 of gallium nitride nanostructures. We have been always focusing on lasers and LEDs in the blue to green spectral range, not in the red to infrared, where gallium arsenide is a leading material. I will talk a little bit about whispering gallery modes, zinc selenide microdisc resonators, which are also capable of producing lasing. I will talk a little bit about the cooperation between University of Bremen, my group, and others with Dr. Jairo Velasco and his wife, Dr. Alejandra Castro Carranza. And finally, I will give some sketches on our new field spectroscopy of two-dimensional materials and will explain at the right time what that is. Okay, let's start with the LEDs and lasing. I guess I have not to tell you as experts in optics that LEDs are taking over nearly everything worldwide. Just remind you that in 2015, 36% of the electricity used by commerce and industries has been used just to lighten halls, plants. So it's a waste of energy, and now they all try to use LEDs for, of course, and there's a trend of minus 4% per year at the moment. Lasers, you know, are used for telecommunication, but also for contact-free materials testing, quantum cryptography for safe data transmission, lowering energy consumption, and much more efficient data handling, and so on. Okay, I think I have not to explain you how a laser works and what induced emission is that I did to the students in Veracruz. I would like just to draw your attention to this figure here. And we want to have very efficient laser action. We have to concentrate the electrons and holes in a very thin layer, so to have a very huge concentration of both of them. And then, by that huge concentration, we can induce induced emission processes and get very efficient laser action. This layer is surrounded by wave-guiding layers, since you have to guide the wave of your emitting laser, of course. And the outer layers are just to guarantee for total reflection at the interface between these waveguide lasers and the outer lasers. And the reason why I show you that is the following figure. We in Bremen produce our own laser systems, and this is an example of a blue-green or bluish-green to yellow laser, where the active layer consists of a quaternary mixture of materials: cadmium, zinc, sulfur, selenide. This quantum well has the lowest bend gap of all the materials you see in this figure. It is surrounded by a waveguide composed of zinc, sulfur, selenide. Unfortunately, you will not see that in the last row, but you may believe me. Then there is a cladding layer composed of magnesium, zinc, sulfur, selenide, and some additional layers which simply allow to make electrical contacts to the system. We need a substrate, since the total thickness of such a structure is only probably 100 nanometers or so, and a substrate one can easily use gallium arsenide, since the lattice constant very well fits to that of the 2,6 materials. What you always need is a good fitting of the lattice constants, otherwise you will induce strain in the system. Of this system, an outer air is mostly sufficient to guarantee enough induced emission. So that's quite good. And in the beginning of the 90s, I attended this conference. There was a sensation offered. 3M company in USA presented the first electrically driven blue-green laser based on zinc selenide. The elder between you will remember that before the 90s, if you saw displays somewhere, advertisements or so, it had always a reddish character. So the color blue and green was missing. There were only several tricks which could be made, but it was always reddish. Nowadays, nobody would buy a display which is a reddish character. We have all colors available. And as I said, in the beginning of the 90s, people were convinced that zinc selenide would be the right material to overcome this problem. Unfortunately, the 2,6 materials have one disadvantage: when start lasing, they destroy themselves, since dislocations are activated by the laser light and start to grow and move through the material. And companies worked for years to overcome this problem. The record holder is Sony. Sony Corporation in 97 reported 1,000 hours of stability of such a laser system, but nobody will buy a device which lives only for 1,000 hours. You would never buy a Blu-ray player or DVD system which is dead after 1,000 hours. So then, in the end of the 90s, the next sensation came on. That was 1999. I was also attending this conference in Japan, where Shuji Nakamura, that time working for the Chia company, presented the first gallium nitride electrically pumped laser. And gallium nitride is a really ugly material. Whenever you have worked with gallium nitride, you will know the huge number of dislocations, of point defects, and so on. But gallium nitride is completely stable against self-destruction. It does not mind on this poor quality. So physicists are not very happy on gallium nitride, but engineers normally say, if it's working, it's fine. And so gallium nitride took over In 2014, there was a late Nobel Prize for the three inventors of gallium nitride lasers, Akazaki, Amano, and Nakamura. And at that time, it already became clear that gallium nitride will dominate blue lasers all over the world. Okay, I skipped that. So, as a result, just gallium nitride-based lasers came to market, but nevertheless, we went on to work on II-VI semiconductors, since we are basic physicists. And the II-VI semiconductors have some very, very interesting properties on the scientific level. They are, for example, interesting for surface-emitting devices, and they are also interesting for single photon emission on demand. And I will touch that a little, since we are working on that. The advantage of the zinc selenide material system is that it possesses high exciton binding energies. I don't know whether everybody of you knows what an exciton is. You know all that in the semiconductor lasers you have the electrons in the conduction band and the holes in the valence band. And they, in principle, in plane of the film can freely move. But it is a negative and a positive particle, and it is due to Coulomb. It suffers from Coulomb direction, so that if an electron and a hole come near to each other, they are bound by Coulomb direction. That sets free a certain binding energy, so you will find resonances of these so-called excitons, electron-hole particles, bound electron-hole particles, below the band edge energy of the semiconductor. And they are very much dominating. Skip that. So, you see here, for example, a transmission spectrum of such a II-VI semiconductor, zinc selenide-based semiconductor. The band edge absorption goes 2.84 electron volts and larger. And you see essentially only very few emission. Then emission starts to increase, starts to increase, but at certain particular energies, you see a strong drop of the transmission. And this is due to these excitons. There are many specialities which I would not like to treat now. There are so-called light hole and heavy hole excitons, since zinc selenide possesses two valence band, light hole band and heavy hole band. That is not so important right here. But you see that there's a very important contribution to the behavior of that particular semiconductor. And even here you see, this is the formula giving the excitons, which is even of no importance right here. The only thing what I can mention is that an exciton and electric hole pair behaves similar to a hydrogen atom. Hydrogen atom is nothing else than a proton and an electron. And the hydrogen atom provides the n 1 to n square dependence with n equal to 1, 2, 3, and 4. And the exciton provides the same sequence of energy states. There's only a change in the Rydberg constant, which is much smaller for excitons than for the hydrogen atom. But the consequences for the optical properties is seen here. This is the band edge absorption. And then below the band edge absorption, several distinct peaks occur. And this is the lowest exciton state, the n equal 1 exciton state, n equal 2, n equal 3. And the resolution is not good enough to show more here. There are some materials which show up to 30 resonances of that kind. But if you compare the absorption, technically absorption strength of the lowest exciton to the band edge, you see the difference. Excitons are dominating these materials quite often. This is a set showing the different binding energies of excitons. You may all know gallium arsenide, which is exciton binding energy less than 10 mV. Let's look just for zinc selenide. Zinc selenide is over here. The binding energy is nearly 30 mV. There are some exceptions, zinc oxide, for example, with 60 mV binding energy of the exciton. So based on these exciton resonances, we investigated in Bremen so-called surface-emitting laser structures. You will know probably surface-emitting laser structures from other fields and applications. Even gallium arsenide is a material suitable for forming these cavities. But the interesting thing is that we can do that in a way in Bremen by ourselves that is very attractive to investigate them. Since now, remember, the edge emitting laser, the active layer was right here, that is the waveguide, and we had the emission of the laser light back and forth of this bar. So this is the so-called edge emitting laser behavior. Now, you make a trick. You introduce very efficient reflection mirrors on the top and the bottom of the structure. And in any laser structure, you have some spontaneous emission. Spontaneous emission is going anyway under any angle. And these highly efficient lasers, we lose all photons which go this direction. We lose also all photons going on a certain angle. But we catch photons being emitted just perpendicular to the active layer, since they cannot leave the sample. That means they are reflected back and forth in the structure. Now, if the structure is pumped hard enough, this will cause induced emission in the perpendicular direction. So you get a surface emitting laser structure. This structure is very interesting for integration, for example, in chips, where you often want to have the light coming out perpendicular to the chip. The trick is that you can make these mirrors out of a sequence of layers of a quarter of the wavelength each, that you know nearly all, as long as you wear a glass. You probably have a reflection coating on the glass, and it's a simple evaporation of a sequence of layers with a thickness of half the wavelength. Half the wavelength reduces reflection, and that is what you want to reach with glasses, so that you are not irritated by light coming from the back being reflected in the eye. In this case, we want to increase the reflection. For increasing the reflection, we have to use number four layers. So this is a set of layers being number four. And what you have to achieve, for glass you need a very cheap technology for evaporation of such diametric layers on the glass. For those lasers, you aim at introducing these mirrors, we say, monolithically. And that means that we grow the samples by an advanced technology, molecular beam epitaxy, for example. I don't know whether all of you know what molecular beam epitaxy is. That is simply made in the ultra-high vacuum, where you have emission sources of your wished materials, which are directed to the surface of a substrate material, and when they reach the surface, they make a chemical reaction and form a very, very thin, atomically flat layer in the optimum case. That is called molecular beam epitaxy. And that's a very expensive method. You have to guarantee for extremely ultra-high vacuum, you have to guarantee for extremely pure sources and so on. So such a machine costs $1 million around without any extensions. Okay, and what we aimed at in Bremen is not only to grow the active layer and the waveguide by molecular beam epitaxy, but all the layer sequences here. That is tricky. Since we have some changes of the material composition from layer to layer, and we have to guarantee that it remains more or less homogeneously strained. If you get any inhomogeneity, you will get dislocations and you can throw away your device. So, very tricky, but you can believe me that we succeeded. And then, as a next step, in a planar structure, you have a light intensity distribution like that. The maximum is definitely in the plane. And then, due to the reflection of the internal mirrors, the intensity is reducing. When you go down, go up. And then there is an additional trick. This is, frankly speaking, a so-called empty cavity. There is no laser active material seen here, but we want to have laser active material. And then the structure looks like that. The active material is now here, there's you will know that from Fabry Bureau effects an optical institute. Besides, you have a total reflection of nearly 100% in a certain energy range if you could realize the right sequence of mirror pairs. But if there is an active layer in between which has a resonance, and in our case it's often exciton resonances, there is in the middle of this 100% reflection region a strong drop down of the reflection near to zero. And this is exactly the wavelength where you want to have the laser emit your light. Now, I said that we cut it into pillars, and this is again the density distribution, that's for sure, but pillars also develop so-called lateral modes. These lateral modes are superimposed to the general cavity emission of such a structure. So this is the emission of the structure well below laser threshold, below lasing. And if you just cut this structure into a pillar, you come up with new resonances. These are vertical resonances. And the trick is now to bring these vertical, or one of these vertical resonances, into resonance with your emission maximum. So that is an electron micrograph of our pillars. You see that you can grow them between 500 approximately, or even thinner, and 2 microns. And you definitely can be aware of a set of mirrors in the upper and the lower part of the structure, and here's the active layer. You cannot see a quantum well in electron microscopy so easily. Okay, if you now start from very low injection currents, you simply get a diode emission characteristics, since it's nothing else than a PN diode with one of the upper layers is doped p-type and the lower layers, for example, n-type. This laser, this emission is normally broad and relatively weak. Notice the factor of 25 right here, but if you exceed a certain pumping density, you notice that immediately a sharp emission line comes out of this broad emission, and this is the onset of lasing. A slight shift of the energy, I would not like to stress that now, but what you see here is the photoluminescence intensity as a function of the pulse energy. In this case, it was optically pumped, and you see there is a threshold, a transition from diode emission to lasing, and this is typical characteristic of superlinear increase of lasing. Now we wanted to overcome the problem of self-destruction of the 2-6 samples, and my colleague, I have to admit, I'm the spectroscopy person, I'm not the grower of these materials. That has been grown by my colleague, formerly Professor Hobbel, now he is retired. The preceding colleague is Professor Eickhoff, so they grow these structures. So they got the idea. If dislocations are guilty for self-destruction, and dislocations go through the active layer like that, one should replace the active layer by quantum dots, since they are so small that you have a good chance to avoid this, that dislocations really hit such a quantum dot. And that really worked. So they could increase the lifetime by several hours. This is nothing for application still, but very interesting what happens if you introduce, quantum dots in such a system. Okay, let me skip that since I have only 45 minutes. This is just to show you that you cannot only form simple pillars. We have a focused ion beam machine where we can cut everything. This is a double pillar system with a bridge, and then you're doubling of these lateral modes here, which are now polarization dependent. Nice play, but I will not sketch that now. I would, in the second part of my talk, tell you something about whispering gallery modes. And for that reason, we need a microdisc. This is a microdisc. Imagine this is a certain material, very thin material, and this material is standing on a bar, 3 freestanding, more or less freestanding, only in the middle, supported by on a bar. And they behave very specially. In case the circumference of the disk is a manifold of the wavelength, you get a very efficient traveling of this particular wavelength along this borderline of this disk. Okay. The name whispering gallery mode stems from an acoustic phenomenon. This is the St. Paul's Cathedral in Great Britain. And we noticed, I guess already 300 years ago, that if a talker is talking at that position and a listener is standing opposed to him, and even if the talker is just whispering, the listener will not understand anything if the talker directs his mouth to the listener. But if he turns his head at 90% and speaks against the wall, this phenomenon of total reflection at the wall comes up, and the listener now understands quite well what the talker says, even if he is whispering. And that gave the phenomenon the name whispering gallery modes. And you may imagine that it's almost the same phenomenon which I explained to you a minute ago for light traveling at the borderline if the wavelength is fitting to the circumference. And these disks are produced at the research center in Jülich in Germany by the group of Alexander Pavlis, I have a collaboration with. The first steps are just the same as I showed you for the surface emitting lasers, etching pillars, but then there's a step of undercutting the material so that there's only a bar remaining here, and this is a disk. So this is just a sketch. That is a very, very fat disk. So this, what we want to have is a nanometer thick disk. And if you do that, we have emission characteristics of such a disk that if we pump the disk at low excitation densities, it's behaving like that, very broadband emission, like you remember it from the diodes, from the simple diodes. But if you now again increase the pumping density of the material of this disk, at a certain point, at a certain threshold, there raises a very sharp line, and this is one whispering gallery mode. Explained to you, circumference has to be a manifold of the wavelengths, and if you have such a situation, one mode is fitting to the situation, and you have this very similar laser-like threshold behavior for these disks. And this is very interesting, even for applications, but also for fundamental physics. We can improve the coupling out of the laser light if we cut there a certain edge into the structure, which is not very much disturbing or surprise the circulation of the light, and so we get this light emission. If you grow nanowires, this is an example where gallium nitride nanowires are grown on a substrate. And the first question is, when does a material self-assemble growth as a nanowire? The answer is easy. I explained to you concerning the surface emitting lasers that you have to have a very good fit between the substrate lattice parameter and the material you grow on top of it. And then it develops into atomic flat layers. If you do just the opposite, also an MBE machine, you take a substrate which is perfectly not fitting to the material you wish to grow, then the material suffers even at the first and second atomic layer from heavy strain, and to circumvent the strain, the material does no longer grow in molecular layers, but forms islands. And the further growth is only working on top of the islands. You may imagine if you have small islands and there is growth only on top of the island, it grows like a needle. And this is the trick for quantum wires. This is quantum wires based on, nanowires. Quantum wires is only the case if you are in the quantum limit. This is nanowires grown by gallium nitride, and yeah, you would definitely expect that such whispering gallery modes can also occur in these nanowires. Since if you look from the top, hexagonal shape, then you may have similar conditions for the action of these whispering gallery modes, and that is what you see here for some different samples, where you have these whispering gallery modes in different spectral ranges, depending on where you are for making the experiments. Okay, I would like to make some acknowledgements for these two parts of my talk. The first one is naturally to my group. These people have been making all the spectroscopy studies concerning these LEDs and lasers. The former group of Professor Hommel, who is now retired, has grown the samples, and the present group of the preceding person, Professor Martin Eickhoff, is now growing, for example, these gallium nitride nanowires. And I mentioned already Alexander Pavlis from Jülich. So, let me say some words. I have not much time left, probably 10 minutes. Some words about our collaboration with our Mexican colleagues concerning hybrid nanowire structures. Does not fit to ITO. So if you start to grow zinc oxide on ITO, you will get nanowires. And this is a very cheap and low temperature method. Everybody can do that in a simple and relatively simple lab. And the fascinating thing is that the structural properties of these nanowires are near to excellent. They are not much worse than nanowires are grown in, compared to nanowires grown in molecular beam epitaxy. So it's a very easy and cheap method. But there's one big problem. If you want to make a p-n junction out of that, for example, for application in solar cells, you need a p-type material surrounding the n-type zinc oxide. And zinc oxide is under no circumstances to be made p-type. Many groups in the world reported on successful p-type doping of zinc oxide, but none of the reports, I've never seen things like that, none of the reports were reliable and could be reproduced by any other group. So in the meantime, we are convinced zinc oxide is just suppressing any p-type doping. So the idea came up to cover the nanowires by a p-type material, and the easiest way to do that is to use suitable organic materials. For example, in this sketch you see it is made by p-dot, which is easily doped p-type. This is the zinc oxide nanowire. You can put a metal contact to the nanowire and another metal contact to the p-dot, and then this direction of the p-n junction. The only problem is that at the interface of the two materials, many defect and trap states occur. And this deteriorates the quality of your p-n junction. We made some successful experiments that this situation is changed if we have a very, very thin layer of polystyrene. Polystyrene is not a good conductor, but if the layer thickness is very, very thin, it does not disturb. But for some reason, we do not exactly why, it reduces the number of defect states at the interfaces, and the quality of the samples became better. So I don't want to go into details of the growth method. I would like to show you that transparency here. You see that it's not easy. This is an experiment taking two different organic coatings, one p-dot, one polypyrrole. And if you look for the typical emission of zinc oxide at low temperatures, you recognize that it's a black line, that you have some free exciton emission at X. X is always standing for an exciton, or this bound electron volt here. Then you have some donor bound excitons. There's an additional binding energy becoming free, so the donor bound excitons are below the free excitons, and then there's defect emission. A peculiarity is a transmission called SX, and S stands for surface. Since a nanowire has a very, very large ratio of surface to volume, you have many, many surface states, and excitons can also bind on surface states. Okay, but if you now cover this structure by p-dot, you are a bit disappointed, since that changes the spectrum a lot. that's normalized to the maximum intensity, it becomes weaker, frankly speaking. And especially it becomes very broadened. Structures are gone, and you don't want to have that. If you dope it by polypyrrole, you see that the structures are well remaining without one exception. The SX structure is decreased, and that's natural. You dope the surface with another material, polypyrrole, and that will prevent excitons from being bound to zinc oxide surface states. So that was quite nice. But showing that not all materials are perfectly suited for the P dot, I told you that the solution can be to introduce a polystyrene layer. Here I show you a study on the polypyrrole, where this is a catalyst, iron chloride, and we try to cover the zinc oxide by polypyrrole by taking different concentrations of iron chloride, and as you see here, we found an optimum concentration where the p-n junction characteristics is not perfect, of course, but somewhat reasonable, somewhat going in the correct direction. And this is a study concerning the p-dot, or the p-s polystyrene coating. You see here the original emission of the p-dot zinc oxide structure was like that, black line again, and then after polystyrene coating, this is exciton emission, this is impurity transition emission, and you see after coating with polystyrene, the quality became much better, the intensity of the impurity emission decreased a lot. But if you take too much concentration of the catalyst, the situation becomes worse again. We have always to find a compromise, an optimum. Okay, let me skip that and let me take some acknowledgements for this part of the talk. These have been in my group, especially several postdocs, Stephanie Blei, Max Rittmann as a doctorand, and the others here, and I have to mention especially Alejandro Castro Carranza, who spent 3 years at my group as a postdoc, some 6 years ago, and so on. She was very much involved in that cooperation and is now together with her husband, Guido Velasco, still going on with the collaboration with us in this field. Nanowires have also been delivered by the group of Carsten Ronning at the University of Jena. My former postdoc Tobias Voss is now since 5 years professor at the University of Braunschweig and is still cooperating with us. And we have some internal university partners. Lutz Mabler is an engineer treating reactive etching, and he helped us a lot by finding this compromise with the iron chloride. So, last part of my talk, probably allow me to have some 3 minutes.
7 or 8 minutes.
7, 8, well, that's plenty. Wonderful. Okay. This is our new research field on two-dimensional materials. You probably all remember the Nobel Prize for graphene some 8 years ago, I guess, to Sam and Novoselov. Graphene is a fascinating material. The production is very easy. You take tape and take three-dimensional graphite and scratch the tape from the graphite and you get if you are lucky, you get a monolayer of graphene. Graphene is extraordinarily good conductor. It is very stable in the plane. So it's only the hexagonal rings of carbon, and they are absolutely stable. So if you put other molecules on top of graphene, it will mechanically survive that. But it has one disadvantage for a person like me. It does not emit and absorb light. Apart from new experiments, I have to admit, where people found some certain solutions to ask graphene also to do something with light. But for a spectroscopy person, it's really not a good material. Fortunately, there are other materials, other semiconductors, which have similar properties to graphene, but additionally interact with light. And these materials are called transition metal dichalcogenides, TMDs. And the example what we treat especially is molybdenum disulfide. So, this is a material which you get at very low cost as a very efficient absorber. The aim is to integrate it with conventional and newly designed devices. There are bright light emitters. One monolayer is really sufficient for rather intense emission. I never believed that before. I don't know any other semiconductor having such properties. It is also a very efficient conductor. Reduction of energy losses in the device can be expected. People discuss about biomedical applications and first ideas of cheap energy storage, but I have to admit that these applications are still in a very rather preliminary research stage, and I'm not the expert on these applications. But it is a very particular material for a spectroscopy person. Again, excitons are of decisive importance for this material, with one difference. I showed you, you probably remember from the beginning of my talk, this map that exciton binding energies for different materials have been given, between 20 and 60, probably 100 millielectron volts. The molybdenum disulfide supplies an exciton binding energy of 600 millielectron volts, and that means that these exciton resonances survive even at room temperature. So the optical spectrum is really dominated by excitons. It is a direct gap semiconductor. The point is that for two and more layers, it immediately transfers into an indirect semiconductor and becomes optically more or less inactive. So we really need one monolayer sample. So what we aim at the moment is to treat the samples with intentional impurities to reduce intentional defects in a defined way. I come to that in my last transparency. So the method is the same silly method as for graphene. You take tape and remove that material from a block of three-dimensional molybdenum disulfide, and you not end easily with any one monolayer piece flake. Normally, you get a mixture of 5 layers, 3 layers, 4 layers, 2 layers. There are some parts where really many monolayers are seen. This is a microscope figure here right now. You can a little bit more reliable identify one monolayer layers by making Raman spectroscopy. Probably no Raman spectroscopy in this institute. Raman spectroscopy is sensitive to vibrations of the lattice. And you may imagine that vibration of the lattice becomes softer and softer if the number of layers decreases. Since for one monolayer, you have no upper and lower monolayer making contact to the layer, and vibration is relatively soft only in this plane. For three monolayers, you have couple of this line. There's a clear signature of the shift responsible for this behavior, softening of the modes when having less and less monolayers. So after Raman spectroscopy, we can more or less sure that we identified one monolayer parts of our flakes. And the optical spectrum, the emission spectrum, is quite particular. It is very bright. This is material layer just on silicon oxide substrate. What you see here, molybdenum disulfide also has two valence bands, so two excitons with a hole from the lower and the upper valence band, so they are called XB and XA. But as you see, XA is covered by so-called trion emission. If you have additional electrons in the sample, you can form particles consisting of two electrons and a hole. This is also valid for hydrogen atom. You can add to a hydrogen atom a second electron, and then you have such kind of twine-like behavior. And then you have natural impurities, of course, and the impurity emissions are right that here. If you now capsule the molybdenum disulfide, like hexagonal boron nitride, only few layers, boron nitride is optically not active, has a band edge 6 eV or so, does not disturb us, but it improves the quality of our layers by surface effects. And that means now that the intensity increases a lot. I'll show you in a minute, you may believe that for the moment, but also the resolution of our lines becomes better. clear distinction between XA exciton and the prion, and even more clear distinction between impurity transitions. What you have to do to get optimum results is to make an annealing step between covering the MOS2, between boron nitride and measurement, as you see here. If you just cover it, the spectrum does not change too much, but if you now anneal the whole sample for 3 hours at 200 degrees centigrade, then you notice, as I promised to you, the intensity is very much increasing and the resolution of the different lines becomes better. This is our first attempt to add additional gallium ions in the material, and we were successful by focused ion beam to get new impurity transition, this one after gallium irradiation. And this points to the fact that we have the chance to intentionally dope the layers. And you probably know, as optical experts, that these impurity transitions are also discussed now as possible emitters of single photons on demand, so that you have only one photon per impurity per time. Okay, now I should stop, I guess. I would like, lastly, to acknowledge my present group. That is Oleg Kredenko, together with Sven Merkens, working on the TFDs, Laura Petzold, Katrin Seewald, Wilke Seemann, Alex Kurt, and working on the microcavities and the whispering gallery modes. Daniel Baskin is the technician, and the secretary. And with that, I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. We have 5 minutes, 6 minutes for questions. If you have any question, please go ahead. Any comment?
Regarding the whispering gallium modes and the process that you use to produce nanowires, are you limited to the geometry because of the nature of the whisper gallery mode? Is there a way to modulate the whisper gallery mode so you can produce another geometries in the nanowires?
So that we intentionally fit the dimension of the nanowires to the wished whispering gallery modes, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not so easy, since during that growth process of these nanowires, it is very hard for the epitaxy person to get a real homogeneous distribution of the dimensions of the nanowires. So normally you have to fetch out after growth nanowires of suitable quality. So it's really hard for, I think that they are not really able to grow such homogeneity that you have only one particular diameter.
Any other question? No? Any other question? Maybe you wish to visit in the near future of Herman University?
Yeah, you are invited to it, of course.
Well, probably later you can talk a little bit with Professor Kutowski, if you wish. I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
When you mentioned some devices such as organic, well, solar cells and so on, you are using the P-dot polymer.
Yeah.
It's just P-dot or is P-dot and PSS polymer?
The P-dot A. Probably did not get perfectly the point. Is the P-dot?
Yeah, it's just the P-dot polymer, or is P-dot and PSS polymer?
It's P-dot PSS.
Yeah. It's P-dot PSS.
The true expert on this materials is kind of.
In the first case, it's not soluble.
Yeah.
Polymer. So in the second case, it's soluble. With some other issues.
Okay.
Thank you. No more questions? Comment.
Don't hesitate. As long as I'm here.
Well, let's thank again the Professor Butlowski. much.
Thank you.